Hey everyone, and welcome to CIC Media. No matter where you are watching or listening from, we feel honored that you have decided to spend the next 45 minutes or so with us today. We really believe in the mission God has given us here in the Cayman Islands, and we are so happy that you are a part of it. If this content impacts you, we invite you to take a moment, no matter which platform you are joining us from, and share this with someone. If you have any questions or want to connect with us, head over to caymanadventist.org and click contact or call us at 345-945-9029. That's 345-945-9029. Now, let the message begin.
I would use as a subject the issue of grace. I would use as our topic that which is on the thumbnail, two words: wasted grace. Wasted grace. I would point your attention to 2 Corinthians chapter 6 and verse 1. It is a simple, non-complex verse. It is straightforward in its appeal. Its theological depth is profound, but the language is not only specific, but it is simple and it is direct. Can I read the word for you, or could I ask you to read the word with me? It is 2 Corinthians chapter 6 and verse 1. It simply says, "We then, as workers together with you, beseech you that you do not receive the grace of God in vain." Can I read it one more time? We then, as workers together with you, beg you, appeal to you, entreat you that you do not receive the grace of God in vain. The author of our verse is the Holy Spirit. The instrument through whom he spoke is this short, diminutive in stature, frail in sight, troublesome preacher. I believe if he had sent an application to President Moses or President Brown, that their conference committee, their union committee, wouldn't even look at his application if he had applied to be an intern. He's an honest person, and he would have had to write the truth in his application. And among the things you would see in his application is, one, wherever he goes, he causes trouble. Two, his eyesight is poor. Three, he is a frail-bodied person. Four, he was disliked by almost all persons excepting some. His name, Paul. Now, having given you his name, I should also tell you, in his application, Dr. Telemach, to be an intern, since he always speaks the truth about himself, he would also have to include in that, pardon me, P.S., I am also a former hired assassin. He would have to include in there, in his application, I did not like the followers of Jesus. He would also write in his application to be an intern that not only did I not like them, but I got letters from the government to persecute them from city to city. I dragged them and threw them in jail. I went after them like a hound going after a prey. I wouldn't give them rest. I didn't care whether they were male or female. I didn't care whether they were young or old. I was just locked in my own religious view, and I wanted to get rid of all the followers of Jesus. But it is the bottom of his application that would allow President Moses and President Brown to take a second look at the application and ask the committee to give him a chance. So at the bottom of his application, he said, in pursuit of destroying the faith of Jesus, I met Jesus myself. And now I am no longer the same. It is the final part of his application that moved me. You see, he tells it as it is about himself. He said, I am like one who was born out of course. I am not even worthy to be called a disciple, but by the grace of God, I am what I am. And because of what grace has done to me, I believe grace can do the same thing for you. He is saying, give me a chance to make my case. He said, I went after them. I persecuted them because I belong to the sect. I was locked in on the issue of believing that the sacrificial system of offering lambs and bullocks, of offering turtle doves, have been with us for so long. I've been practicing a particular religious practice that I was so locked in it that I couldn't see anything else until I saw Jesus. Until he took me down from my high horse and he called me by my name twice. Not only did he call me by my persecuting name, but he gave me a brand new name. And so, Mr. President, if you take me as an intern, don't call me Saul, call me Paul. Because I heard him say, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? And he said, Mr. President, I am applying to be an intern because he said he will show me how great things I must suffer for his sake, and I am ready to suffer for him. Mr. President, I'm applying for the job to be an intern because he showed me he's going to take me to the islands and the continents. He's going to carry me as a vessel to declare his everlasting gospel. And it is Paul who make the statement, we then, as workers together with you, he is captured by what grace has done in his own heart. He is captured by who Jesus has been to him. And so he was standing there when they were stoning some of the followers of Jesus. He never met Jesus physically. I don't know. But this one thing I know, he is wrapped tight in Jesus. By the time he writes this text, he's been through some stuff, and he's saying to you, if you are afraid of going through stuff to be baptized, he said, let me tell you, don't receive the grace of God in vain, for there is enough grace to carry you through whatever you've got to go through in order to make your calling and election sure. There is enough power in the grace I'm talking to you about. He said, I beg you, I beseech you, I plead with you, I appeal to you, whatever you've got to do, there is enough grace to help you do it. You know, he when you go to the first letter of the church to whom it's addressed, by the way, Corinth, this little place, if you're familiar with the map, Corinth was 4.5 miles wide at its widest point, and not many more multiple miles longer. But it was this narrow strip of land connecting two huge landmass. The issue is that to sail around Cape Malia was so dangerous that folk would, ships would pull up on one side of Corinth, offload their cargo, and folk would drag those stuff across the 4.5 miles to board ships on the other side. There was this phrase that says, let him who sail around Cape Malia, let him who sail around the other side of Corinth, first write his will before he begins to sail. Corinth. And because of the important trade route that Corinth was, all kind of everything could be found there. You even find a temple of Aphrodite, where there were 1,000 prostitutes who were priests. There were priests in the day and prostitutes in the night. Are you listening to me? Corinth was a funny place. It was in Corinth that you find Sicilian goat hair that would make this expensive garment and an expensive rug. You would find Iconian wool. In Corinth, you find luxury material of all kinds. Corinth was the place where luxury and poverty, where wealth and debauchery, where drunkenness and reveling find home. Paul spent 1 year and 6 months, the longest time in any place. It was not a comfortable place. Why did he spend such a long time there? You find him in 1 Corinthians chapter 1 talking about it. And then he said, can I read it for you? I didn't plan to, but let me just jump over there quickly. Give the old man just a minute. I'm running to 1 Corinthians chapter 1. I'll come back to our text in a moment. But let me give you a background to our writer and the text. He said in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, the preaching of the gospel, the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but to us which are saved, it is the power of God. He said, we preach Christ crucified. To the Jews, he is a stumbling block. To the Greeks, he is foolishness. But to them who are called, both Jews and Greeks, we preach Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. Greeks prided themselves on their knowledge. Greeks have this concept that what knowledge can't give you, you can't get anywhere. Sounds like Sigmund Freud. Sigmund Freud said, it is foolishness to believe that you can get from a belief in God that which science cannot give you. Sigmund Freud said, belief in God was good for the infancy of humanity, but now that humanity has come of age, it's time to throw this barbaric God aside. But Sigmund Freud is dead and God is still alive. Are you listening to me? Hear the preacher. The Greeks in Corinth seek every day to discover and know a new thing. And Paul comes with the simplicity of the gospel. But somebody here ought to understand that God can use the simplicity of the gospel to cut down your wisdom, because God knows you'll get to some place in your life where your learning can't help you and your wisdom can't help you. You'll come to some moments in your life where your doctors can't help you and your scientists can't help you, and the God whom you reject may be the only one on whom you can call. Are you listening to me? And so you got to understand how the Greeks practiced the craft of the word, so that when John was writing, the Holy Spirit guided John to send the gospel in the context of the Logos. He was writing in this context where they prided themselves on wisdom. And so he would help them understand, in beginning was the Word, the Logos, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and the Word became flesh. Ah, and when they said to Jesus, Master, the Greeks, we have some Greeks who want to see you. Can you understand his answer when he said, I beheld Satan like lightning fall from heaven? And he said, now is the kingdom of God glorified. Because hear me. There comes a time when you've got to sit down and ask yourself, with all I have, with all the things I've been through, with the best I have amassed, where do I go from here? Where do I go from here? It is the grace that he brought to Agrippa and caused Felix to tremble. It's the grace that he brought to wisdom, to wise ones, and caused them to humble their hearts. It's the grace that caused him to suffer the stuff he suffered. Can I share something with you from his suffering? Before I get there, he wanted to understand that there's an ultimate aim, there's an ultimate end, that this grace is leading somewhere, that the gospel he brings leads somewhere. And so he quotes from Isaiah in 1 Corinthians 2 and verse 9. He said, eyes have not seen, nor ears heard, neither can the heart of man conceive and perceive the things that God hath prepared for them that love him. Your eyes can't see it. And to help you understand how much he was willing to suffer for it, let me share something with you from his own writing. He said in 2 Corinthians 1 and verse 8, for we would not have you ignorant of our trouble which came to us in Asia. Listen to me. I'm going to preach today to two groups, those in church and those out of church. Sometimes, those of us in church, the devil uses trouble to cause us to let go of the hand of God. Are you listening to me? He can't read your mind, but he watches your actions. He observes you. And there are some of us, the harder he hits, the tighter we cling. There are others, the harder he hits, the further we run from Jesus. And so Paul said, I don't want you to think that I'm just writing stuff to you. He said, hear my story. When I talk to you about grace, hear my story. If you're in church, hear my story. If you're out of church, hear my story. He said, I don't want you to be ignorant of our trouble which came to us in Asia. We were pressed out of measure. We were pressed above strength in so much that we despaired even of life itself. Do you understand the psychology of the language here? He's saying, listen, the trouble that came to us, it defies, it extracts, it was beyond our strength. We got to the point where even life itself, we despair of life, but by his grace I am what I am. And I beg you, do not receive the grace of God in vain. For when trouble comes down in your living room and death comes creeping through your window and your money is acting funny and your children are on drugs and your marriage is in trouble, it's the grace of God that will hold you together. He says, listen, do not receive the grace of God in vain. If you're in church, the road behind you is longer than the road before you. We've come too close to the kingdom of God to turn back now. I'm almost on the doorstep of heaven. I can't go back. I won't go back to the way it used to be. I'm pressing on the upward way. I'm nearing my Father's kingdom. So he says, I know the devil's sophistry. He's going to use grief. He's going to use death. He's going to use agony. He's going to tear up your life. But he said, I beg you, do not receive the grace of God in vain. Because there's no trouble that you can face that grace, hallelujah, has not already made provision for you to successfully handle. For you to successfully handle. For you to successfully handle. And sometimes we slide back and lose our membership because we have failed to understand the provision of grace. So he said, I beg you, I plead with you, do not receive the grace of God in vain. In short, let not grace be wasted on you. Let not grace be wasted on you, because you cannot exhaust the power of grace unless you slam the door shut in the face of grace. And so hear me, former members. The fact that you slip back, the fact that you have lost your hold because the devil turned up the heat, God asked me to tell you, he loved you just the same. He asked me to remind you that the only reason the lost coin was found was because the woman who is sweeping the floor placed a value on the coin. And God says, listen, the same way she's got, what happened when you sweep? You sweep and you sweep and you sweep away dust until the coin shows up. Well, God, even by the gospel, is sweeping away the dust of your life, sweeping away the stuff you've been buried under. Grace is sweeping away. I don't know if it's common law marriage. I don't know if it's drugs, but grace is sweeping, 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 because God placed a value on the lost coin. Can I tell you? The coin wasn't lost in the street. The coin wasn't lost in the bushes. The coin was lost in the woman's house. You can be lost right in church. Are you listening to me? I said, you can be lost right in church. And he's saying, I beg you, do not receive the grace of God in vain. Because God is sweeping the house. God is sweeping the house. But also, grace tells us of three lost types. For the boy, he knew his way back. And for him, the father did two things. Kept on praying and he kept on waiting. Maybe your mother died praying for you, backslider. Maybe your daddy died praying for you. Maybe husband, your spouse who's still in the church is praying and crying her heart out right now for you. I prayed with a woman. She sent me a voice note. I stopped in my half-bed state. I heard her tears. I sensed her pain. I said to her, I can't call you back right now, but I'm praying for you. And her heart is bleeding over a son that has drifted. Hear me. You may be listening to me right now, son. I'm going to take 2 minutes more and tell you. This lost boy left home. If you put him in a modern context, maybe he was driving a high-speed, super-duped-up Ferrari. I don't even know which car you like now, but the one that you like, he was driving that. Same one. The same one that you like. He was driving that. Matter of fact, his ATM card was of such, he doesn't draw small change. There were not very many machines that could handle his withdrawal. He has that. But he got to the place where he understands that sin can wear you out. That sin will take you further than you plan to go. And sin will hold you longer that you intended to stay. And sin always costs you more than you can afford to pay. I told you last night, I was 14 when I was baptized. As a Methodist boy, I didn't know much. I didn't know many things, but I had a burning desire. I hated Adventists. I hated Saturday. And I'd go up by the little Adventist church in Burnt Savannah. I mean, it was so big that if you go in there and want to turn, you have to come out sideways and turn because you can't turn in there. A tiny place, if you please. And as a teenager, I didn't like them. And so on Saturdays was our free day. And I had a trucking company. Yes, I built my own truck, built by Samuels and Samuels. Had a huge engine, and you can hear me driving, boom. And when I got to the church gate, you hear my horn blasting. You hear my engine revving. But God has a way. If you have an open Bible, an open mind, and a clear conscience, you've got to obey the commandments of God and keep the Sabbath of the Lord God. If you have an open mind, an open Bible, and a clear conscience, you cannot resist the seventh day Sabbath. You cannot resist the Ten Commandments. If you have an open Bible, an open mind, and a clear conscience. My parents threatened to turn me out. I had no Adventist friend. There was no Adventist in my family. We were Anglicans, Baptists, and Methodists. So on that Saturday morning, December 30, 1972, don't calculate my age now, I had two pants, like two trousers, and I never had a problem. They say, bring a change of garment. Member of Parliament Rob, I just see you. Bring a change of garment. I never had a problem, Dr. Telemach, because I have on one and only have one more. Easy, simple. So I put the other one in the bag, put a shirt in there, and there's a tiny garment with two small holes and one big hole. I put that one in there too. Pack my bag. My great-great-grandmother, I'm talking to a child, I'm talking to a teenager who's listening to me right now. My great-great-grandmother, who owned the house, said, if you ever leave this house to join those wicked seven devil people, don't come back in here. I have no place to go. There's a burning desire that I can't go back, because the word is clear. And Paul said, I beg you, do not receive the grace of God in vain. And trepidatiously I walked. And it seemed like 10 miles up to the church. It was just a half a mile. It seemed like 10. And all along the road, everybody come out. You are still the boy. You are still the boy. No. I know you're watching me from Polish country, but let me be my old country boy preacher. We're giving you 6 months to turn back. I buried most of them. And grace has still kept me here. But that's not what I want to tell you. Sometimes you think I preach without pain in my heart. In my first boyhood evangelistic stuff, my brother, who's a year older than I am, Miss Icy, I know you're watching, and it may tear up your heart, baby, but he came, and I'm making the appeal, and he got up and ran outside. When I got home, I asked him, why did you run? He said, if I'd stayed a minute longer, I would have come to the altar. I pleaded, I begged. A few years passed, preached again. He came, but he said he wasn't quite ready. Now I graduate. I was facing graduation. I got an appointment in Boston. And on my way, I don't even know how they got to somebody they knew I was going to stop with to board the flight the next day. They told me he was hospitalized. I had planned to stay for some days, you know, country boy going to big city. But I decided I'm going to head back right after the end of Sabbath. I'll catch a flight on Sunday morning, flew into Montego Bay and headed to the Mandeville Hospital. I got in there and the nurse at the desk, I'm asking her, can you tell me where Stanley Samuel's bed is? And she said, oh, the doctor wants to see you. I said, me? I said, no, I just want to see my brother. She said, come with me, sir. The doctor wants to see you. And I walked with her, and the doctor, who was inside a little cubicle, she knocked and she said, sir, pardon my intrusion, but the brother of the patient that you were concerned about is here. And when she said concerned about, I asked him, what's wrong with him? And the doctor said, your name is Glenn, right? I said, yes, but how did you know my name? He said, well, let me talk with you. Can you sit down? I said, no, I want to see my brother. He said, sit with me for a while. And he came from around his desk and he sat on the chair beside me. He said, all night, last night, he kept calling your name. His blood pressure is through the roof. His sugar is out of control. His kidney isn't functioning. His lungs is showing signs of trouble. He was in so much trouble that I have to be honest with you, sir. I doubled the medication trying to see what else I could do to keep him alive. And it sent him in reverse so that when you go by his bed, he's breathing, but he's not talking. But talk with him. The doctor said, you are a pastor. I said, not quite yet. I have a year left. I said, how did you know that? The doctor said, because he kept calling your name, saying he is ready now to be baptized. He kept calling your name all night long. I stood over his bed, but he never made it out alive. I stood over my brother's grave, my mother's first son, my father's first child, saying, dust to dust, ashes to ashes. My mother almost died. I don't know why Paul said it, but he said, I beg you, do not receive the grace of God in vain. Paul talked about himself. He said, I've been shipwrecked, but I'm still here. I was stoned and left for dead, but I'm still here. He said, I'm still here. Paul said, I'm here not because of my wisdom. I'm here because of the grace of God. Paul said, I belong to a religion. I thought I was right. And I fought against that which I thought was wrong until that which I thought was wrong was proven by Jesus to be that which is right. And willingly, I gave up that which I was clinging to. He said, I did that all because of grace. And he said, now I can tell you, there is neither height nor depth. nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come. And he asked the question, who shall separate us from the grace of God? Because the grace of God comes wrapped with the love of God. How do I know that? The Bible tells me, for God so loved you, and you, and you, and you in China, and you in Kingston, and you in Grenada, and you in St. Lucia. For God so loved you, you there in Sabah, you there in Guyana, you there struggling with common law, you there struggling with drugs, you there struggling with sex, you there struggling with alcohol. For God so loved you that he gave his only son, that whatever you need him to do, there is enough grace to break the shackles, there is enough grace to pick up the broken, mend up the broken, there is enough grace to pick up the fallen. You know, where sin abound, grace doth much more abound. I beg you then that you do not receive the grace of God in vain. The everlasting gospel comes to kings and queens, prime ministers, presidents, members of parliament, parish councillors, legislators, street sweepers, teachers, and lawyers and doctors. Because you see, grace is not concerned primarily about your profession. Grace is concerned about you. Grace has a work to do that only grace can do, and grace cannot do it if you slam the door in the face of grace. And so the text is clear. He said, we who have been won by his grace, we are workers together with him. God, you don't understand this. You don't understand this. God save you to be his partner, that somebody else may be saved. Hear me, businessman. You may not be baptized today, but God has a function for you. God has a purpose for you. 2 weeks ago, this man walked in here, an engineer. He had just gotten word from the hospital that his wife lost his baby, the first one, but he came in his pain. He walked right in that baptismal pool because grace soothes your grief. Grace can hold you together. Grace can do what psychoanalysts can't do. Hear me, drunkard, a slave to liquor. If you only give God's grace a chance in your heart, you will need no detox center. If grace has his way in your life, I beg you, do not receive the grace of God in vain. But I hear you. Maybe you're wondering, why are you watching this link when you're not a Christian? That's grace. So let me tell you one more story. I'm in this tiny island attached to the Colombian Union. My friend, Vanston Archbold, was president of this little tiny island. And they brought me, he said, Samuels, my classmate, can you come and do something for me? I'm talking about God's amazing grace. It took me 4 planes to get there. And he said, we have a guest house for you. I said, no, I want to see the tent. He said, no, you need to go. I said, I can't rest until I see where I'm going to preach. And reluctantly, he took me there. And when I got there, I knew why. It was just a tent pitch. The grass wasn't cut. No seat, no nothing. I pulled off my jacket and said, can you find somebody with a hammer and a saw? Can you find 2 members with some nails and some board? And I have to confess to you, with my left hand, I'm holding up the sun. And with my right hand, I'm brushing the grass. And he started brushing. With my left hand, I said, God, you remember the prayer that the man prayed and you held up the sun and allow for some sunshine? I said, slow down, Sabbath, for a little bit longer. Got there on Sabbath morning. By Thursday, I got into a meeting, and they said to me, please don't mention the commandments. Don't talk about the Sabbath. Because down here, we don't even have license to marry anybody. It's a Roman Catholic Church that dominates, and so all our weddings have to be done by a Roman priest. And we don't want to have any trouble. I said to the young pastor, I don't have money, but I'd rather pay you back what you pay to bring me here. I can't do what you're asking. I can't do what you're telling me. Because if I do that, I'll be a prisoner for the rest of my life. Are you listening to me? And so we've been there first week. I'm into the second week. A car pulled up at the guest house I'm staying. I didn't know who they were, and they asked for me, and the lady was very protective. She said, sir, and who might you be, please? And he said, so I'm looking through the window, and I'm eavesdropping through the window, you know. If you call my name, I want to hear what you're saying. And he said, no, we asked just to come and talk with him, because the director of the airport's authority wants him to do something. What thing? He said, ma'am, may we speak with him? We have no handcuff, we have no... So I came and I said, let me talk with them. He said, sir, they've been recording your sermons from you got here on Saturday. And they've asked me to come to ask you if you would allow them to move the meetings from the tent down to the National Center. They will send the buses to carry your church people. But they have some young men and they have some young people that they want to hear what you've been saying. Let me cut the story short. For 10 years, they baptized 12 persons. That was from 10-year period. They baptized 12 persons. Well, all of that is going on. So I went down to this center, and there was standing room only. And in the room was a Catholic gentleman who owned his own boat. And he walked up to me and he said, how much do you charge for Bible study? I said, how you mean charge? He said, what you say is so important that maybe I can't even pay. But if I can't pay for an hour, can you give me half an hour and tell me how much it would charge? And I'd come by where you're staying. I said, no, I'll come by your house and I'll spend the whole day and I'll pay the charge myself. I went to his house and he said, I have some questions. Do you know what he asked me to explain? He asked me to explain Revelation 13. Do you know what Revelation 13 talks about? It talks about the mark of the beast. And I said, God, you're amazing. And I explained to him Revelation 13 and Daniel 7 and Daniel 2 and Revelation this and Revelation that. And he said, aren't you preaching tonight? I said, yes. He said, well, it's almost preaching time. I said, my, the time is gone so far. He said, I heard you talk about fishing. Can I take you fishing tomorrow? I said, sure. Now in Jamaica, my fishing, I stay on the rock and I throw my line in the water because I'm safe right up here standing on the rock. Now he picks me up and he's driving and I'm not seeing any rock. I see the ocean and he pulled in and I see this boat. I said, the Lord is my shepherd. I see what I don't want. I'm talking about the grace of God. I'm talking about a Catholic millionaire. I found out later all he wanted was just more time for Bible study. We're out on the bosom of the ocean. And then he said to me, don't look, we have company. I said, but where? I didn't hear anything. And between my last statement, two speed boats pulled up. There were DEA agents. I've never seen anything fast like that. And they had no manners. My mother taught me to say good morning or good afternoon. They just jump right over, hook some stuff onto our boat. They They jumped over six of them and they turned everything upside down. They looked at us looking the stuff. And as your queen, they were gone. Here's what I'm going to tell you. The man came the night. He walked down to the altar. He called his wife, who was in another country, and asked her to book a flight and come even for 2 days. I walked out into Colombian waters, baptizing 40 persons for the glory of God. Among the 40 was not only a number of former Catholics, but here's this one story. The man would sit in his car by the roadside, never come under the tent. And the last night, before the Sabbath, when I'm closing, he touched me on my shoulder. We sat and talked. He said, "Can I drive you home?" The driver they got to drive me said, "No way, Jose. You're going to drive in this car if you want to talk with him." We chatted. In the morning, I'm on my way to board the car for the church, and he pulled up and said, "I'm coming right behind you." When he was baptized, he said on the Saturday night, he has Colombian police officers on his pay bill. He doesn't pilot his drugs himself. He has persons who pay the bill. If grace could make a drug dealer a child of God, if grace could make him walk away from all of that, can you understand why Paul is saying to you, do not receive the grace of God in vain? I'm done. I'm on my way to the airport, and they stopped me and said, "There are two persons who have decided you cannot go home without baptizing them." And I'll make the story short. I have at my home or on my desk that little ball, the one that is a girl's game that you hide your hand behind your back and they throw it. He's a star. We stopped, baptized him. Within weeks, he had an accident. They airlifted him to the Medellin hospital, unconscious. They carried his wife to the hospital. She called me from his hospital room, and she said, "It's a miracle." He opened his eyes, and among the final words he said, "Tell the preacher, grace brought him here just in time." Just in time. And he died. I don't know if Nora is still alive. I don't preach fancy sermons, just the plain and simple gospel. And before there is a song, before there is any music, I have a red gown in my hand. Grace brought somebody here this morning. Grace brought you here this morning. I don't know how long God has been wrestling with you. I don't know how many things you've been struggling with, but I know grace brought you here this morning. This gown is yours. There is no song now. There is no music now. Just the voice of the Holy Spirit talking to you. And if you do not want to receive God's grace in vain, I want you to get up from where you are and walk down here and take this gown from my hand. There is no music now. There is no singing. You know that God brought you here. You know that grace brought you here. Maybe you're sitting right up there near the baptismal pool. Maybe you're sitting right down here. Maybe right now your heart is racing. your mind is troubling you. Maybe there's a throbbing in your breast and you can sense it. You know that this moment is yours. This gown is yours. You know right now, maybe you were once a member of the church and the devil dragged you out. I beg you, do not receive the grace of God in faith. Are you worried about the job you have? Are you worried about the relationship? Are you worried about the stuff that you think you can't live without? I beg you, do not receive the grace of God in vain. You're sitting right in here. You're sitting right in here. The Holy Ghost didn't bring you here just to sit down. God brought you here. He's talking to you right now. He's talking to you right now. Get up from where you are in the name of Jesus. This gown on my hand is yours. If I were you, I'd change my foolish ways. If I were you, I'd walk down and say, yes, Lord, yes, to your will and to your way. If I were you, I'd say, out of my bonded sorrow and night, into thy freedom, gladness and light. Jesus, I come. Where are you? I'm praying in my heart when I'm preaching to you. And if I must help you, I'm going to ask everybody to stand. If I must help you. So let me make it easy for you. You're standing. Just make the next motion. Put one foot forward and then the next one and the next one. Come on. Because you see, the journey ahead of you is shorter than the journey behind you. I know you've been through some stuff. Maybe you cried yourself to sleep last night. Maybe you got so frustrated. Maybe you're sick and tired of being sick and tired. Maybe you've been hearing the gospel so long, you've gotten used to it, that it is losing its impact on your mind. It's losing its force. Maybe you've grown so accustomed to putting God off that the Holy Ghost, the voice of the Holy Ghost is almost silent. I beg you, do not receive the grace of God in vain. Come on. Today is your day of victory. I don't care what you've been through. I don't care what you're in. The only thing that God cares about is that you'll come to Him just as you are. And so to help you, I'm going to ask her to sing. The twilight is fading. The day soon shall end. You get homesick the farther you roam. But the Father will help you each step of the way. Because now you're going home. Going home. Going home. There's nothing to hold you here. Now somebody is praying for you. Somebody is praying for you. And with your heads bowed, while she sings, you're there in Kingston, you're there in Westmoreland, you're there in Waterworks, you're there in Lucy, you're there in Hanover, you're there in Georgia.
Praise God.
You're there.
Praise the Lord.
And I want to ask you.
Praise the
Lord. You're here and you once walked with Jesus. I want you to walk out. As she sings, walk out from where you are. If you're standing, hold a second. Lord have mercy. I know. I know how difficult. Hold a second. I know how difficult it is. You walked here with a friend. Maybe you brought a friend, a visitor, somebody who's not yet baptized. Maybe it's in your family and you came here together. We know it's social distancing, but I want you to touch that friend that you brought here. Touch that former member that you brought here and say, come, let me walk with you. Let me walk with you. Let me walk with you down there. Would you touch that friend you brought here? Would you touch that former member that you brought here? Would you touch that brother, that sister that you brought here that's not yet in the fold? Say, come, let me walk with you. said, come, let me walk with you. We've been friends together. Come, let me walk with you. I'll be your support. Come, let me walk with you. I know it's difficult, but come. Come, let me walk with you. Come, let me walk with you. We came here together. Come, let me walk with you. Touch that person on the shoulder. You know they're not yet in the fold. Say, come, let me give you some moral support. Let me walk. Oh, hallelujah. Let me walk with you. Let me walk with you. Let me walk with you. Touch that person and say, I'm taking up a blue gown now. Touch that person and say, let me walk with you. Let me walk with you. We've talked together. Come, let me walk with you. Oh, hallelujah. Come, let me walk with you. Come, walk with me. The road is long. Come, walk with me. Come, walk with me. Come on. There's no song. It's just the voice of the Holy Spirit. You're in Guyana or Trinidad. Maybe you're in your home watching on the screen or watching on your smartphone. You know a number you can call. Call that number and tell them, I've made up my mind to walk with Jesus. You're in Belize. You're in Atku. You're in Cayman. You are in Providenciales. You are in Grand Turk. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on. Good to see you today. We spoke last week. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Dr. Talimak. Come on, come on, come on. Walk with your friend. Oh, God bless you. I see you come, I see you come, I see you come. Come on, come on. Walk with the person. Walk with the person. You came here together. Say, come, let me walk with you. Come, let me walk with you. I won't let the devil take you without a fight.
In my childhood.
Yes, yes.
Have traveled.
Yes. Yes.
So far.
Yes. Come on.
By nightfall.
You're in Turks.
How weary I grow.
Come on. You're in the Berry Islands.
For the Father.
You're in Abaco. You're in Grand Bahama. You are in Nassau.
Let me.
Come on. Take that walk to the altar. You're in the Cayman Islands.
Each step of the way.
Take that walk. You're in the Savannah Church. Or Georgetown Church. Or Ephesus. Or Northside. Or East End. Or West End.
We'll be going home.
Take that walk today. Come, let's go home together. Come, let's go home together.
Going home.
Come, let's go home together.
I am going.
Don't let the devil sidetrack you.
Going home.
Come on.
Come on. Nothing.
Come on.
No, no.
You're in Tobago.
To hold me.
You're in Tobago. You're in Guyana. You're in Saba.
Hold me here, yeah.
You're in Montego Bay. You're in Mount Salem. You're in Westmoreland. You are in Portmore. Come on. You're in Hagley Park. You're in St. Mary or Clarendon. Come on. You are in St. Thomas.
Praise God.
You're in Portland.
One of these.
Take that walk. Go down front and talk with the pastor.
Praise
talk
God.
With the pastor.
Praise
say,
Lord.
Devil, I'm not going back the now same the way I came here.
It's fading. The day.
Sing the song. Yes.
Will end.
Yes. Yes.
I get yes. homesick. And
I get homesick. The gown on my hand belonged to somebody else here. The gown on my hand belonged to somebody else here. Come on to Jesus. Come on to Jesus. Walk out and come. Walk out. Walk out and come. Walk out and come. Don't let the devil hold you back. Walk out and come. You're here today. Do not receive the grace of God in vain. There's power in the blood. There's power in his name.
My child, we're going home.
Sing the song, child. Sing the song. Sing the song.
We are going. Wing home.
Yes, sir.
We're going home.
Fred Neil
God.
Gordon.
There is
Henry
nothing,
Brown.
No, nothing, no, nothing.
Erica Donaldson.
To hold me.
I see you've made
to
the decision.
Hold
you're ready for baptism.
Oh, God,
struggling. within the city. You're in this auditorium. You're in the hearing of my voice. You're standing in here. You're standing right here. Grace brought you here. Let grace take you the next step in the journey. I said, grace brought you here. Grace brought you here. I beg you, do not receive the grace of God in vain. I came just to deliver that simple word. Just that simple word. Grace gives you the power. Grace gives you the strength. Grace gives you overcoming victory. Grace can dry your tears. Grace can open your doors. Grace can fix your situation. Grace, wrapped up in grace, is the power of the living God. That's why the Bible said, now found grace in the eyes of the Lord. He entered the ark and the others were destroyed. I'm done. I'm done. But this gown belongs to somebody.
We're going.
Blue is the color
what the day that will be
of obedience. Blue is the color
now
of loyalty. This gown on my hand belongs to somebody in here. Grace brought you here, and grace want to fix you up.
I'll get homesick.
I want to make that decision today.
Homesick.
For the grace of God is available. The grace of God right now wants to do something for you that nobody else can do. This gown on my hand belongs to somebody right here. Today to the altar, today to the water. I'm done.
And he said, my child, one of these days, we're believing this earth will be going home.
We're going to sing it one more time. Before she sings the next stanza, somebody here needs to be prayed through. Somebody here needs to be prayed through, needs to be prayed through, needs to be prayed through. And so I'm going to ask, where is the pastor? I'm going to ask Dr. Graham, there's a private room right behind the stage. There's a private room right behind the stage. I'm going to ask you, would you take these folk who are standing right here, Pastor Williams, would you take them with Pastor Graham? And Dr. Talimak is going to come. Dr. Talimak is going to join you in that prayer room right behind. It's the room I need to pray in after meeting each evening. Somebody here, you need to be prayed through. Would you go to that prayer room? Would you go to the prayer room? You can go this way right through that door around there. You can go that way right to the room around there. And I'm going to ask Dr. Talim to go with you and pray you through. Today has got to be your day of victory. Today has got to be your day of transformation. You're going to go right there. And I'm going to ask now the ones who are robed for baptism to come. But I ask, is there somebody else? You're saying, I need some prayer, Pastor. You're saying, I need some prayer, Pastor. I'm not yet baptized, all right. I once was in the church and the devil dragged me out. I'm going to ask, oh, bless the Lord God, I see you going. I'm going to ask her to sing, and she's going to sing it out with all she's got now. And this time, it's for you. If you need some prayer power, and you're still standing in here, I'm going to ask you to walk right out and stand on my right on this side, you need some prayer. You're struggling with some issue. I mean, we all struggle. You're struggling with some stuff. And you're saying, God, I need prayer. I need to be prayed through. I need some victory. Our heads are bowed and they're standing to do the vows with these. But I want to pray for you and with you before the vows are taken. And she goes, sing two stanzas powerfully for you. I'll just listen and wait while you come. Come on. Walk right over on my right. This is your moment. Come on. You know you need some power. Come on. God bless you, sir. Walk right over on my right. I know the time is gone, but come on. There's a decision that you've got to make. Come. Walk right over on my right.
You're longing to see.
Yes. Will you this moment? Would you this moment?
Will you?
Would you this moment?
This moment.
His grace receive.
His grace.
That's what church is all about. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Going to pray for the ones here in the road. Well, let me take a minute just to pray. Thank you. Grace comes with convincing, convicting, converting power.
Oh God, our Heavenly Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus. Nothing in our hands we bring, but simply to your grace we claim. You said to Paul that your grace was sufficient to keep him. The psalm reminds us, God, that we are going home. The twilight is fading and the day soon shall end. And God, we don't want the day to end and our souls are caught out there in the darkness of sin. And so for these who've come, Jesus, for these who have come, they're struggling with some stuff. They're climbing up some mountains. They're struggling across some Red Sea. Let the power of your blood, let the power of the Holy Ghost do what only grace can do. I pray for sons and daughters. I pray for mothers and fathers. But God, I pray right now for these who are standing here. Break the chains, break the shackles, pull down the strongholds, tear down the prison houses. But I ask you in the name of Jesus that you would grant deliverance, because God, a battle is raging and somebody standing here today need to move from where they are to find a gown and say, God, I'd rather die than to live without you. I'd rather die than to go on living this way. Deliver somebody. Thank you. Somebody's being set free, God, not just in this place. Somebody is being set free across the four English-speaking unions. Today, God, we give you the praise, the honor, and the glory. Thank you for grace. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, we pray. And let God's children say, amen. Amen. Amen.
Thank you so much for tuning in today, and I hope you were blessed and encouraged by your interaction with this content. If you have any questions or would like to take the next step, head over to caymanadventist.org and click contact, or call us at 345-945-9029. That's 345-945-9029. May God bless you richly.